Good morning, church. Good morning, church. Thank you.
What's so good about this morning, church? We're all here.
Amen. Worship the Lord. Wow. Could be a better place. Father, here we are today before you. We like that year.
For making it possible for us to come, because you, through the shed blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. And now God can look upon us. God can smile with us. And God can love us. Father, we thank you for your good pleasure upon your people. And here today, to worship you, we have come. And so, Father, put a song in our heart. Put a spring in our step. Boy, just release our tongues and emotions to sing to the glory of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. How you like our new quartet over here? We encourage all of our youth to come help us out. And we have our drummer's on vacation, and he's training a young man over there, and they'll all be back next week. So at this time, we'd like to ask y'all to stand and sing Send a Great Revival.
Coming now to thee, O Christ, my Lord, trusting only in thy precious word, let my humble prayer to soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Let the Holy Spirit come and take control. And send a great revival in my soul. Send the Holy Spirit. Burning out the dross and guilt of sin, let the mighty works of grace begin. Oh, send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Let the Holy Spirit control and send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival, Lord, in me. Help me that I may rejoice in thee. Give me strength to win the Send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Let the Holy Spirit come and take control. And send a great revival in my soul. Help me go for thee, dear Lord, to some lonely souls that's gone astray. Help me lead them in the homeward way. Oh, send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Let the Holy Spirit come and take control and send a great revival in my soul.
You're sounding good. You may be seated.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. A better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know it just ain't right. When there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain.
If you'll all stand now and sing with us, Your Grace is Enough. This will be our offertory.
Great is Your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters and to mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember. Your grace is enough. justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Yeah, your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Yeah, your grace is enough. Heaven reaching down to us. Your grace is enough for me. God, your grace is enough. I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me. It's enough for me.
Thank you very much. Y'all be seated for just a minute. I'm gonna take just a couple minutes, but that's okay. Y'all, it ain't gonna be that long. First thing, we Greg Taylor, I need a little bit more personality out of this one. If we could just squeeze some want to out of this one. Y'all.
It just comes easy to her.
Listen, I know worship service is reverent. I got it. But there is nothing better than seeing that right there. There is nothing better than seeing these young children on this stage, because this right here is your future.
That's right.
If they ain't the future of this church, they are the future of another church. They are the future of the church, right? So I applaud y'all for getting up here. I love hearing y'all sing. I'm so happy that y'all are up here. So it takes a lot to stand up here, I know. And it takes a double lot to dance while you're up here. So I am loving it. Now, your mom and daddy ain't loving it. I'm just telling you. A couple things. Pastor Church Committee meeting. We are going to meet today. If we have not, definitely we are going to meet today after church. I want to share with y'all a little bit. I told y'all from the beginning that you would be a part of this process, right? The survey was a part of that. I'm going to update you as I can. I want to share a couple of things that came back from that survey. We got a lot of really good responses. We got a couple of questionable ones. One of them was, what is the greatest challenge to our new pastor? And somebody thought that teaching Buffalo to fly would be a good answer. If you wrote that, I'd love to hear some interpretation, because I don't know that a pastor is going to be faced with that unless that's a metaphor that I'm missing. We did get a couple that said, let God lead, not a survey. I want to be real clear. The survey's not picking the next pastor. Okay, just so we're clear, the survey served multiple purposes instead of just... The survey's not picking a pastor.
Amen.
So don't think that we're taking that and putting somebody into a box, and if they don't check all the boxes, then that's not how that works. So I appreciate you being, you know, trying to lead us into, you know, what God wants, and that's exactly what we're doing. So we have narrowed it to six. I believe the number is six right now. We're going to meet today and try to get it narrowed down further. And I can tell you that those six, in my opinion, and I think that I share the same opinion with the other members, they're all qualified. They're all overly qualified to be the leader of a church. We just got to figure out which one is the leader of this church. And we believe as a committee that that person has already been chosen. And our prayer from the beginning has been that that person knows that they're already chosen, and we just got to arrive at the same conclusion. That's kind of where we're at. So they go all the way from, they range in age from early 30s to late 50s. They range in educational experience from just a little to check all the boxes of all the degrees that you want. So he's out there. And we are going to get to the person that God has set aside for First Baptist Florella. I'll share a little bit about the survey. I can tell y'all that out of the 40 whatever responses that we received, our senior adults care a lot about our youth. That is an overwhelming, I can say the word overwhelming, response. The majority of the senior adults that filled that out, their primary concern was our youth. So all y'all young folks think them old folks don't know nothing. They love you and care about you, I promise you. Okay, so you have the support of the older generation, the seniors, the golden agers, whatever you want to call them. They have your back, and they're there for you. If you saw on Facebook recently, we're going away from Facebook Live. That is happening. Joyce has created a YouTube channel. Now, some of you may not know, you have to have a YouTube account to subscribe to something, okay? So when you go to the YouTube page for First Baptist Church of Florella, you have to click subscribe, and it's going to ask you to log in. Hey, we need 100 of y'all, okay? I don't care if you ever go to YouTube again ever in your entire life. Make an account, subscribe to the page, and do whatever you want to. I don't care. So after that, Joyce can get a specific YouTube address. It won't just be a bunch of letters and numbers and gobbledygook. It'll be First Baptist Church Florella, whatever she wants it to be. So go to YouTube, subscribe to the channel. The last thing, and I promise I'm not going to holler at y'all, y'all did really good for the first 5 months of this Operation Christmas Child bucket out here. I mean, really good. I don't know what happened, but usually in the second or third week of the month, it's full. There ain't nothing in there. So go back to your June and figure out what's supposed to be in there. Let's continue doing what we're doing, because it's going to be a whole lot easier in November when we get there. I promise, okay? So Lord's Supper at the end of service today, we're going to do it a little bit differently. We're going to do it prior to the invitation. So some of y'all folks have been sneaking out. He's going to catch y'all today. y'all just be still. All right, let's go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for your many blessings, God. We thank you for the wonderful opportunity. We consider it a joy to be here in your house today. We ask for special prayer for everyone who has a part in the service. And we ask that we hear from you and not Bill Pritchett. God, we trust that the words that you have given him come directly from you, and he is just the messenger. Mm-hmm. God, at this time we take a moment to attempt to give back for the many blessings that you've given us. God, a time that we can show our thanks and gratitude and appreciation for what you've done with us. God, we ask that your blessings on this offering as we continue to bless you as you've blessed us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
After our doxology this morning, we'll release the children to Children's Church. So if you'll all stand for doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him.
Take your Bibles this morning and turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 26, and I'll read a text in just a moment, but just want to share a couple things as we begin. I believe that everything that's written and everything we can understand in God's Word has relevance for how we live our lives every day as a child of God, whether it's Old Testament or New Testament. And that is true of the Lord's Supper, even and especially, if you will, the Lord's Supper. So generally speaking, when I do the Lord's Supper, I do a message. Not necessarily a full-length message, but I do a message, and I do a message from a text about the Lord's Supper. And the reason I do that is because so many things written about the Lord's Supper in the text that we have in the New Testament containing that story and those directions speaks to how we live our life every day. The Lord's Supper is not just something you come observe once a month, once a quarter, once a year, whatever. It doesn't give us any specific time in the Scriptures when and how often to do it. It just says do it. And as often as you do it, do this. And so I hope to challenge you today. Three simple points. Won't be a lot of hoorah in any of them, but they are important to your walk with God. And so that's why I always like to put the invitation at the end of the Lord's Supper. The reason being, I don't know of any visual in Scripture other than the cross and the empty tomb that speaks so clearly to people as does the Lord's Supper. And so then the invitation is, because some of the things we're going to talk about, some of you out there aren't doing. Probably hadn't done them in a long time. Maybe hadn't even thought about doing them. But maybe today, God's Word will say something to you that when I offer the invitation, you'll come. You'll walk down, share what God has said to you, to me, and then we'll move forward appropriately from there. Okay? So this is special, the Lord's Supper. And there are only a few texts that speak to it, and this is kind of unusual. The Lord Jesus only took it one time with his disciples. He took it one time, the Thursday night of the Passion Week. By Friday, he is dead, and Sunday, he was alive and heading up to heaven. So it's important that we understand something of what is taught about the Lord's Supper. And several of the Gospels speak to it, and Paul pretty extensively speaks to it over in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 as he spoke directly to the church at Corinth. And if I have time during my tenure here, we'll probably get to that text. And it's an important text because it teaches us so much about how we should be living. So let me read the text for you today, Matthew 26. And verses 17 through 23 is going to be kind of a lead-in, an introduction. And then here in verse 26, it says, as they were eating, that means they were observing the Passover meal. This event occurs the Thursday night of the Passion Week. The next day, Jesus was crucified, died, and was buried. The last meal he shared with his disciples. So as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, gave it to the disciples and said, take and eat it. This is my body. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood that establishes the covenant. It is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. But I tell you, from this moment, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it in a new way in my Father's kingdom with you. And after singing psalms, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Now, y'all know I'm an old cowboy fan, okay? Now, I won't ask for a show of hands because there'll be a gob of people here that wouldn't know who I'm talking about, but there's going to be some of you that are. Some of y'all are going to remember Roy and Dale Evans. King of the Cowboys, right? Yeah. And they used to end their show every time they aired it with this song, until then. They talked about until we meet again. And singing that little chorus, they were talking about that they hope things go really well with you until that time. But it also gave you an anticipation of something to come. Until then. Until what? Until they come back on the TV show and we watch them again the following week. There's an until then thought in Jesus' giving of the Lord's Supper as recorded in the Gospel of Matthew when he said, I will not drink it again until. Until what? Until he takes it afresh and anew with all God's people in heaven together forever. And so there are some things that are taught, very simple things, in this very simple scripture that I want to see if we can get people here today to grasp, okay? So until then, Jesus says in this passage some things that we should hold near and dear to us, some things that we should seek to fulfill in our own personal lives. Take a step in the life of our family. Take a step in the life of our extended family, and on you could go. And so until that great celebration in heaven called the marriage feast of the bridegroom, it's going to be a party. If you think that people party down here, you haven't seen anything related to that party that'll take place up there. And so until that happens, Jesus says, I want you to remember some things. First of all, he tells us that I want you to live under a new covenant. He mentions the word covenant there in this text. And so he says, and they were eating, and Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, gave it to the disciples and said, take and eat it. This is my body. Then he took a cup after giving thanks, gave it to them and said, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood that establishes the covenant. So we need to understand what a covenant is. A covenant, simply defined, is God's way of life being lived every day and life being lived in relationship to him. You see, a covenant is God's binding agreement with his people about what he has promised them. And it demands a sense of obedience. It is a call to live like God lays out for us in his inspired word, from Genesis 1 to the last word in Revelation. And so the covenant relationship is extremely important. God began making covenants as far back as Abraham. It's called the Abrahamic covenant. And in it, when you read it and study it, it talks about and focuses a lot about what's going to happen down the road. And so then there was a Moses. Moses had a covenant. And several other covenants were established. And each spoke about that binding relationship that God makes with you. In other words, God will never break his promise to you. Now, you're going to let him down. And you're not going to please him all the time. And his hope is, by what he's done on the cross, well, you will confess your sins and come back to him. But I'm here to tell you, he will never break his promise to you. It's binding because he set it in a covenant through the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're in a covenant relationship. But not one that's from Abraham or Moses or on through the Old Testament, but one that comes to us through the person and life of the Lord Jesus Christ. God has made a covenant with us that is binding on him as to how we are to live with one another, how we are to live ourselves, and how we are to relate to him. So, whether you know it or not, whether you agree with it or not, every Christian is in a covenant relationship with God. We live by our covenant relationship with him because he is faithful. What God promises, he will do. And what we commit to him, we need to commit to him. And how we live on this earth because of all that God has done and the great sacrifice that he had to make in order to seal this covenant, the shed blood of his one and only son, then our commitments, we should be faithful. We talk about salvation is free. Well, it is for you, but it wasn't for God. It wasn't for Jesus. God had to give his only son that your sins might be forgiven. There was no other possible way, no other sacrifice that could have been given. And so God establishes this covenant with you, and he wants you to live in it. So the celebration of this memorial meal acknowledges that God has established a new covenant with you and with me. That is the foundation of how we relate to him, how we relate to one another, and how we live our lives every single day. 600 years before Jesus, a prophet by the name of Jeremiah prophesied this covenant would be made. 600 years before Jesus ever came. And he, Jesus, established this covenant. So, and the beauty of one of the beauties of this covenant, it's not set in stone. Now, sometimes when you say it's not set in stone, it means you can break it. But that's not what I'm talking about. The Mosaic covenant was set in stone. The law written by the finger of God on stone or tablets. And it was the covenant that people lived with for many, many years. But God did not write this new covenant on stone, on paper. No, understand this is key. God wrote it on the heart of every believer that puts his or her faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. God didn't just write it in a book. He writes it on your heart. That's why we say to become a Christian, to live under a new covenant, is what Paul called being made a complete new creation. You are a new creature in Christ. Behold, old things pass away, all things are new. And so, just as in the Passover meal, when they broke the bread and gave it, that was to symbolize the haste in which Israel had to leave Egypt. You just had a little bit of bread and you had to go. When it was time to go, they had to go. They couldn't tarry. And that's what the breaking of the bread meant in the Passover. But when you come to the new covenant in Christ, the breaking of the bread, the sharing of one loaf, and it's really a beautiful experience to see a church be able to celebrate that and observe that by being able to take from one loaf. But sadly, sometimes science and medicine prohibits a lot of things that we take their word over before we take God's word over. But when Jesus broke that bread, it was symbolizing his body and his blood. When he broke that bread, his body was going to hang on a cross. His body would be punctured with a spear. His blood would pour to the ground. His life would not be taken from him. No, he voluntarily, he willingly took your place and gave his life for you. And in that process, when we take the Lord's Supper, we're seeing the breaking of God's Son. It's not about haste. It's about ultimate and great sacrifice. So when you get your little wafer today, I want you to think of the sacrifice that God made for you. All he did for you. And not one event. He does it for you every day, every moment of your life. God never leaves you nor forsakes you. He's with you all the time. And he's pouring out his grace and his mercy. Why? Because of you? No, because of his Son and the covenant relationship that binds God to do what he's promised to do. If it hadn't been bound in the shed blood of Christ, there's no telling what we would be like today if any of us were still here. But he did. And so, to become a child of God is to share and understand in the sacrifice of what God has done for us and the binding agreement he has made. When you take that cup of wine, we're not drinking literally the blood of Christ, although there are some denominations and some faith that teach that, but it's just not biblical. But we are understanding and acknowledging what that blood has done for us. The Bible says God cannot look upon sin. We are born with Adam's nature, every one of us. Everyone that ever has been born since Adam was born with Adam's nature, which means when the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, every person sinned. And so every person needs redeemed. And so redemption could not be provided with the sacrifice of a lamb or a dove or some other animal or some other way. God said, and he determined it before the foundations of the world were ever laid. He determined the only thing that's going to cure the problem that man is going to put on himself by sinning is for my son to die in his place. That's the covenant under which you live every day, every moment of every day. Listen to what Hebrews 10, 16 through 17 says. This is the covenant I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. He adds, I will never again remember their sins and their lawless acts. Do you realize how blessed you are to be a Christian? I will remember their sins no more. He's put it here and here so that your emotions and your understanding can meet together and know just how blessed you are. And I am. And are all Christians. So that which was once written in stone is now written on our hearts. And so, to partake of the Lord's Supper means you understand you're living under a new covenant with God. All right? The law is passed. Jesus superseded. He fulfilled the law and the prophets. So those who try to pattern their life after the law, you're wasting your time. James says if you break one law, you're guilty of them all. You don't stand a chance. There is no way you can make it by the law. If you don't understand in partaking of this meal that it is the grace and the mercy of God upon you through this covenant relationship with Jesus and his work on Calvary, then you have no hope of getting into heaven, none whatsoever. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. There's no way to heaven except God's way. And God's way is for him to take the righteousness of the law and write it on your heart and your mind, connecting your passion and your understanding so that you live every day for him. So, to partake of this is an acknowledgement that you're living under the covenant. Number two, it says that he gave it to them. Who was them? Well, they were the disciples. Who was present? All of them. But there came a point at the observance of the Passover as they moved into the Lord's Supper, just before he instituted it, that Jesus told them, somebody tonight will betray me. Oh, man, they all got to see him. And he said this, the one who dips, sops with me. Well, understand something. By that time, every disciple in there had sopped with Jesus. Everyone. And so they all started saying, is it me, Lord? Can't be me. Is it me? Is it me? And then there seems to have taken place, if you put the Gospels together, a quiet discussion between Jesus and Judas. And Judas quietly said to Jesus, so the others couldn't hear, is it me, Lord? Is it I? And Jesus said, you have said rightly. And at that moment, Jesus turned, and Jesus said, go and do what you do quickly. And he immediately went and sold his Lord for silver. The rest of the disciples went on and partook of the Lord's Supper. So who is he giving this to? The redeemed and only the redeemed. Now, this is not very popular, but I'm going to say it. Using the Lord's Supper to teach your kids by letting them partake of it and then not being redeemed is hurting your child, not helping your child. It's not a teaching tool. It's an act of great sacrifice and an act, an expression of great love. So then how should you use the Lord's Supper with your children? You should tell them. When Jesus instituted that, the one who sold him out didn't partake of it. He left. And so it is for the redeemed and the redeemed alone. It's for the church. And there's a great temptation that comes when it comes to this Lord's Supper. And that is, some people get in their mind that they're more spiritual than everybody else, so that they begin to feel like, well, there are times when they ought to take it by themselves. Nah, that's sinning. This is a group effort. This is a covenant with a people, not a person. Sometimes certain groups can get off by themselves and say, well, you know, let's partake of the Lord's Supper. We're such a close group. Don't do that. It's for the church gathered, not a specific group off by themselves, thinking more highly of themselves than they should be. It's for the church. So who makes up the church? The redeemed. Who are the redeemed? Those who have turned to God. They've left their old way of life. They turned to God. We call that repentance. They put their faith and trust in Christ. They believe that Jesus is God's only Son who died on the cross to make it possible for my sins to be forgiven. All right? So far, so good. But then, it's also for those who were baptized. You see, this is for the church. Now, how does somebody become a part of the church? Well, you don't just come down and state your faith and walk away and it's over. To become a part of the church, the Bible lays some things on in terms of standards. In the book of Acts, when Dr. Luke writes this great history of the flow of the church after the Gospels, it talks about and has some summary statements in there. And like on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 people were saved and were added to the church that day. And they were baptized. So the second requirement of church membership is your faith, but your baptism. Now, your baptism doesn't save you, just like works don't get you to heaven. But just like works that validates that you have faith, baptism validates that you have believed. You're saved when you believe. You become a part of a local New Testament church when you're baptized. That's the symbolism. That's the event that gives testimony to all who sees and hears about it that this person is a part of this church. So you need to be a part of a local New Testament church. You live under a new covenant, and you locate to a nearby church. When he said he gave it to them, that's who he gave it to. And then, once we've been made our profession of faith, and we've been baptized, and as Baptists, we believe there's just one mode of baptism, and that's immersion. That's what the word means in the New Testament. Baptism means to be immersed. And so there's only one way that I know to immerse. You either lay them down and bring them up, or you stoop them down and raise them up. Whatever it is, you go under, which symbolizes you die with Christ. But you come up, symbolizes you're a new creation. And one day, you will rise to meet him. And so here we have the context of the church in the Lord's Supper. It is for the redeemed. Now, every time a church meets, it's going to have people that aren't members. So what do? Well, some churches have gone to the far left. I think it's probably the far right, and it's got a little bit too legalistic. And they say that if you're not a member of this church, you can't partake it. For many years, the First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas, was a church that only the local church members could partake of it. But we've progressed, and I think in a healthy way. And so when I extend an invitation for people to partake of the Lord's Supper, I never say you have to be a member of this church. I do say you must be redeemed and you must have been baptized. Now, I'm not going to argue with you over the mode of baptism. But if you're going to establish a church membership here at First Baptist Church Florella, and you haven't been immersed, then you will need to be immersed. Because that's the baptism we accept. And because it's the baptism that Jesus himself underwent. John submerged him. Submerged him. So, here we go. The Lord's Supper is about a new covenant, a relationship with the local New Testament church, but it's also a time when we look for our next celebration with Jesus in person in a new way. Now, Jesus doesn't define how that new way is. I have no clue. I just know it won't be like the old way. And I know that all things in heaven are new. All things in heaven are better. All things in heaven are perfect. So however it is that Jesus is going to sit down at that marriage feast of the bridegroom when he and the church are merged in heaven, fully consummated, coming together, absence of sin, life in eternal all together in heaven, how are we going to observe that one great celebration? I don't know. But it will be new. And that's what I invite you to as a Christian. Anticipate that. I don't know of anything that will affect the way you live than knowing what lies ahead. Than knowing what lies ahead. What's waiting for you. And the resurrection for some is going to be a resurrection unto death, unrighteousness. But for those who believe, there will be a resurrection unto life everlasting. And so, knowing what awaits us, a hell or a heaven, well, those are the two most motivating things I'm aware of about living a life that honors God. For what he has waiting for us is so much greater than anything we may have given up. So I'm inviting you to the Lord's table. Are you a believer? Have you been baptized? If you haven't been baptized, I would invite you at the close of our service, at the invitation, you come forward and say, I'd like to make an acknowledgement that I am a believer, and I'd like to be baptized, and I'd like to do it here. And we will set up a baptism for you. So have you been baptized? Are you living with any unconfessed sin in your life? That's a dangerous thing for a Christian, just to let sin ride. Take it carelessly. Even the Lord's Prayer, the model prayer, says, forgive us of our sins as we forgive others. Forgive us of our sins. Are you living with unconfessed sin? If you are, if you will humbly ask God to forgive it, he will. He's bound to. It's the covenant he's made with us. Are you a member of a local church? The New Testament knows nothing of a Christian without a local church. And I don't mean as negatively, but that's why sometimes with the many groups that are out and about and functioning in various different ways, I used to always tell our minister of music is, I want you to find out where their church memberships are before you bring them here. Because a lot of them don't have church memberships. They see their gathering is all they need. And brethren, that's woefully wrong. Everybody needs a church. Like baptism, it doesn't save you. But I guarantee you this, your growth will be stunted if you're not a part of one, if you're not active with it, and if you're not growing with other people. I've never met a Christian that wasn't baptized and didn't have a local church membership that didn't think of anything but himself. It was all about him or her. Well, I want you to know when you come out of the new covenant, it's all about Jesus. Not us. and not someone else? And are you living by grace, or are you living by the law? If you're living by the law, you're in deep trouble. If you'd like to come under grace, at the time of invitation, you need to come and receive God's free gift of salvation for you. And it's a gift. It has nothing to do with you. In the scriptures it said, many are called, but few are chosen. What does that mean? Everybody gets the invitation. At the marriage feast of the bridegroom, those servants went out, even into the highways and the byways, ultimately, inviting everybody to come. Many were called, but few were chosen. Few repent and turn to Jesus. Few refused. Many refused to not get baptized. Many refused to join a church. Many refused to let their life be governed by the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Who are the chosen? It's not a select group. It is anyone and everyone who will turn to God, believe that Jesus is the Son of God, submit to the rite of baptism, and become a part of a local New Testament church. Now, everything after your faith in Christ is sort of peripheral, but it is significant because it is a huge validation. And without those other elements, you are only hurting your own personal life. Kind of like Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. When Philip led him to Christ, what was the first thing he said? What hinders me from being baptized? And Philip said, nothing. So they stopped at the first puddle. They stopped at the first pond. They stopped at the first whatever they had to get him underwater. They stopped and they baptized him. That didn't save him. But I'll tell you what, when next time he talked to the queen, he said, I have been saved and I was baptized by the evangelist Philip. Guarantee you, he didn't just say, I believe. I'll never forget my baptism. I hope you never forget yours. It's significant in your life. So I invite you to come. So bow your heads for a moment. We're not going to linger here. Bow your heads for a moment. And if you have some work to do with God by seeking forgiveness, now is the time. Come to this sacred table, not because you must, but because you can. Come to this sacred table to testify of your sincere love for Christ. Come to this sacred table because you are in need of heaven's mercy and help. Come to this sacred table because you want to love God more. Come to this sacred table because he loved you and he gave himself for you. Would our deacons come forth and prepare our table?